Hello, Brother Anthony.
Brother Billy, you're sitting there now, but you wasn't there, and I had gone out with that before. And I hung up my jacket on you. Is that okay? No, because, you know, you're surrounded by books and maybe some chairs and a nice bin you got there is always empty because they like you, but you don't have a lot of hangers. That's not what we're talking about today. Here's the thing, Brother Billy. You know, I've talked to this a bit time about perception and all that stuff. I also explained to you I don't believe in this whole racial black, white, whatever thing is a false construct to me. But, you know, people have taken it to heart over the years, you know, over the centuries. And there's a thing they call racial profiling. Mm-hmm. And what that, now that's just a big way of saying, like, A, if you see somebody that's a darker skin than you, and you, well, you got a, you know, an instrument of destruction, like a gun or whatever it is, or whatever they, you can use it against them, and then nothing will happen to you, because the structure, the big power structure, you know, goes on. But this is not necessarily, then again, it is in Africa, you see? What they're doing is, it's not just, that's what I'm saying, I don't like this false construct of race, because I think it happens to be the haves and the have-nots. Now you say, well, that's class war. Not exactly that. Let me try to explain this another. Let me go back to my childhood in the South Bronx. Now, my first, well, not my first, well, look, my girlfriend, when I was 14 years old, you know, 14, they call it puppy love. Oh, sorry. But, you know, Renee Jeanette Fairley, beautiful, beautiful woman, girl. You know, we both the same age. She was actually born 5 days before me. She was an older woman. Oh, okay. So anyway, you know, she lived, because I lived in the Patterson Projects, and just when I was of age, that age, they had sent a lot of drugs into the community a few years early to get rid of, to disperse the gangs, because they was afraid the gangs would be politicized by the likes of Malcolm X and Lorraine Hansberry and James Baldwin. You know, we were reading those kind of people and listened to those kind of people. The South, they were doing the whole, you know, kumbaya, you know, want to integrate, but we North, we were like, hey, something wrong here. So we were listening to some more radical people. So there was the fourth authorities. They were afraid that, you know, we were going to be politicizing, the gangs would then turn against the system, as it were. You know, and this happened in Chicago, Blackstone, Rangers. But anyway, it's gangs. But by the time me and my passing project, sort of the gangs sort of dissipated and the gangs around. So, but we still had gangs. Now, Renee, my girlfriend at the time, she lived on 147th Street between what's called St. Anne's Avenue and Willis Avenue. It's a very long block. Now that gang, that on that block, there was a, every block, I mean, some blocks had gangs in it. Now that gang was a particularly vicious Puerto Rican gang called the Schemers. And I think about a couple of blocks down, or maybe 145th or whatever, there was a gang called the Suicides. Maybe I get them confused, but anyway, it was a gang. Now, one thing about the gang is about turf. And they don't like people who are not like them, others. Now, it just so happened, you know, Renee, like me, like I said, we almost looked like twins when we, you know, when we got together. We, you know, so she was, you know, she was black and ended the block. She lived at the end of the block, close to St. Anne, so I had to come from the Patterson. And I had to go through all the gang block. But you know something, they never bothered me. Why? Because I wasn't bothering one of their women, you know? And they realized that, you know, that, you know, Renee, she, and I guess nobody, Renee and Bob, we were both like skinny little kids, you know? So I guess nobody was interested in Renee in that block, you know? So we were cool. So it was cool. So I had no problems with the gang. Even though they knew us from the head of Patterson, probably another area. And I was really what we call an other. I was other than them. Now, when I look at that kind of book, let me tell you another, just a tiny big example. I know it's going to be kind of long here. But when I was older, like in the 90s, there was a particular thing where, you know, people were besieged on, like, black people and kill them. I think in New York, it was like the Michael Stewart cake, the squad, all kinds of cases. And there was a case in Brooklyn, I forgot the name of the brother. Anyway, in that area, I happened to have an acquaintance, let's put it that way, pretty polite, that I would see sometimes in that area. Nice young lady, and when this all was happening, I was in her place, and at night I was going home, and I come across some people of that area in Brooklyn. It's a white area of Brooklyn, and they were sitting on the thing, looking for trouble, and I'm walking by. Ooh, they stopped me. blah, blah, blah. Now, we see, I'm from the South Bronx, and we have a certain code, da, da, da. But the thing is, we don't run away. You know, we just, you gotta vibe your way through. When I say vibe, you gotta really push your thing. Because you can't push it to a point where you're challenging, you know, six guys. Mm-hmm. Anyway, it turns out that they let me go. It's no problem, you know, so I kept on going. I bring all this up because in these days, when people make people others, so when you have this thing where you have a police force, for instance, that is a one other, and they're monitoring or enforcing in a neighborhood where they perceive these people to be other than them, other than human beings, less than them, or maybe even they figure that, hey, if these people, you know, rise up, it'll threaten my way of life, or whatever they're thinking. And this is a worldwide. This is not just, once you make somebody another and they're no longer human to you, and more importantly, here's the trick, here's the big problem. They got firepower. Mm. They got, they may use rubber bullets one day and tear gas one day, but the next day, just like we happened 2 years ago, was Americana's anniversary, they might use live bullets, even on the same people, as long as they're the others. And now these people, here's the other trick. The people that are being monitored, they can't become a part of the police force because they come upon the police force, then they can know. But my point really is in that whole thing is that they are just, their system, at least in New York, we were systematically deprived of that because if they put you through a system for any, you have any kind of record, that means you can't get a job in something like the police force. So then you have a community that you deprive of policing themselves or deprived of jobs. And you see how that vicious circle goes? And oh, it's like a systemic thing. So all the problems happening in the world today, you're not gonna get rid of it because this systemicness of it prevents you from doing that. And a perfect example, you get a president of a country or a prime minister, whatever have you, they can't do anything because the system that they're in has perpetuated this otherness. Mm. And this culture of, we're going to take all that we can, and even if you complain, we'll delay it through our court system. So even if you get justice 5, 6, whatever years later, well, we've done a whole lot of damage in those 5 or 6 years. We've further inculcated, I got that, that's a nice word, inculcated the system with our way of thinking of making people others. Mm. So I know this is kind of complicated. I was thinking about it. And I'm just thinking, how do you stop this? Hmm. I think the system is based on economics. So you have to, not destroy, you have to alter the economic system so there's no economic incentive for them to make a bullet to shoot you. There's no incentive for them to make a situation where they're taking from you and then they have to defend their taking from you by, well, making you a criminal rather than them who have been taking from you the criminal. See, it's that whole reverse kind of thing that's happening. But these are just thoughts. No, it's only coming from the ArtsDirector Emeritus. And this is one of those dispatches from me, the ArtsDirector Emeritus, that would be T. Me, T. From the Pattersons. I mentioned that Patterson Project, taking the train to Tibet, letting you know what I only suspect. Ah, see.